just ruined them forever.
Okay, so just in case you guys need a refresher, or perhaps you haven't done this before, we have maybe 10, 15 minutes for questions. So if you have one, you should raise your hand early. We'll try to point you out. You can just shout it down. I'll repeat it into the mic, and then I'll just pass it off to you. Cool. Right up there.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah?
Hi, sorry. Thank you very much for making this film. I'm just curious if there's any recent developments. Does Bloor still exist in Philadelphia? Any sort of recent things you can tell us about?
Sure. The question was, are there recent developments? Does Bloor still exist in Philadelphia? And the answer is they do still exist. They have a house in a suburb of Philadelphia called Chester. And I screened the film with Ramona and members of them about 2 weeks ago. And they're in a different phase now. They're in their activism phase, and that was their confrontation phase. And they, in a lot of ways, have a lot of sort of, they feel vindicated in a lot of ways. They say things like, our hair doesn't look so strange anymore now that all the football players wear it that way. And, you know, they used to say we were so weird. You eat raw garlic, you smell bad, and now it's a wonder food, right? Now the raw food diet is all the rage. I think they are different in their nature. There was an incident around 2001 where there was sort of a custody battle with a mother who was in the group and a father who was outside the group. And it seemed to be sort of, you know, bubbling up again, and the cops were there, and the community resource people were there, and it's like every day the press would come, and the cops would be like, no, it's not going to happen, we're talking to them every day. And so nothing happened, but then the husband in the custody battle was murdered, actually, in 2001, so that was sort of a little end note there.
Right there.
I think that I have a question about the film. Because the period that you talk about, 85, the bombing, was very different than the period of 76 and 78, because I was there in 76 and 78. And what I missed about the film was the context of the movie. Because it grew out of a political radical movement of students, other activists in the Palatine area at the University of Pennsylvania, at Drexel, and that was basically became one of the major forces of the confrontation between Rizzo and the rebel and students who rebelled at that time. That movement, particularly, I was part of that, was involved in that, and that was to me, a very important part of the MOVE philosophy and the idea, because it goes back to the student rebellion. The second part was a very different, and I think borne out brilliantly in terms of the way you use the footage, that was a very different period, the contrast between the 70s and 80s. Did you look at trying to give the contextualization of MOVE in the earlier period, or what was your attitude toward that?
The question was, I think, broadly about context and more specifically about the context in the neighborhood during 76, 78 and how it differed. And I guess I would say, it's a push and a pull when you make the film because, I tend to agree with you. I think the context, and I think there's a whole film in that incident, right? A whole film before you even get to 1985. I think there's a whole film there, but that's not the film that I was making. And then if you go even broader than Philadelphia and that neighborhood, I think there's valid questions about how does this relate to the civil rights movement, and how does it relate to the Black Power movement, and how does it relate to all these things? Or maybe the most straightforward way I can think of putting it is if you were, an intelligent young African American person living on the East Coast of the United States in the early 70s, what would make this attractive to you? Do you know what I mean? What would make this a reasonable alternative? What was going on in our country that was so crazy that this would seem reasonable? And I think those are all excellent questions. They're just not what I was doing with the film. And I think for the most part, maybe not the specific context that you're talking about in that part of the city, which I think is very interesting, but I think a lot of the rest of the context is more available than this story. So my feeling was to try to present this story focused on 85 too, present this story sort of in a self-contained way, present it as a story with integrity, and then sort of allow those offshoots to happen for the audience, right? So if, I'm basically pleased if people want to go out and research different parts of the story, whether it's Rizzo's history and the police brutality, whether it's things coming out of the racial history of the United States that led to this, and sort of where we decided to sort of draw the borders around the film was to just tell the story there and allow it to be sort of a discussion starter and a provocative piece to allow people to go and choose the parts of it that they were most interested in to find more about. So, I don't really disagree with you. I think it's very interesting material, and I think the dynamic that is, kind of given short shrift in the film is that the neighbors were rather supportive of MOVE in 78, and that made a huge difference why the cops really couldn't do anything about it. I basically agree with you. I think there's a huge contrast between the 78 incident and the 85 incident. It's not even all of it. I think it's even more complex than the discussion you and I are having at this moment. But you have to center the film somewhere, and we decided to center it in 1985.
Good answer.
Yeah, just wondering the extent to which major national and international news organizations, how much attention they pay to this issue, and whether or not you felt the amount of attention they gave it was justified.
So the question is, how much attention did national and international news give the incident at the time? And I was a kid, I don't remember that well, but my understanding is it was sort of a blip on the national news radar. It hit CNN for about two evenings, and CNN was very young at the time as well, very new. My understanding is that it actually in some ways was covered more and as a story was better known actually in Europe. Harvey Clark, who you see, the reporter, he was always struck. He said that, obviously he was going to Philadelphia for it, but not in other places, but he traveled to Europe and traveled to Paris in the early 90s, and people would stop him on the street and say, "Hey, you were that news guy when they burned the city down in Philadelphia." And that would happen in Paris, where it wouldn't happen in, say, Philadelphia is different, but it probably wouldn't happen in Atlanta, let's say, but it would happen in Paris. So, was there enough coverage? No, I would say, I'm not even sure it's about news coverage. It's not really news's job necessarily. But I guess where I engage is that it's not in the history books, it's not known as a thing. And I definitely think that's, one of the pieces I take up is for it to be part of history as opposed to swept under the rug. Jim Jones. The question was it before or after the Jim Jones incident?
After.
So it was early 80s, right, Jim Jones?
78.
Okay, sorry. was it in the hearing? No, they didn't ask. They didn't make that comparison in the hearings at all that I know of.
Okay, right there. No, that woman right there, sorry.
So, thank you. The question was about process and just how we, accessed the archive and brought it together in a film. And it took a long time. A lot of the archival material was at one archive at a university in Philadelphia, but it was sort of under lock and key. And I had to battle for a long time to sort of get the resources till they'd let me use it. And then it was a tremendous amount of material, so organized. For instance, the hearings ran 3 weeks televised. And we had all of that hearing material, and we also had all of the legal transcripts, and we scanned them in and used optical character recognition, which they didn't have at the time, so that made it all searchable to us. So we were able to search the hearings for specific words, which was a huge help. It was about 20 to 25 hours of live news footage. We had it all transcribed, including camera angles and movements, so we could basically read it. And then, you know, once you sort of know what you have, it's you're just making a film. You know, you're just cutting scenes. And, it's in a way, once we sort of knew the ground rules, it was, I think, like cutting any film. A film with a large ratio.
I'm just wondering what the neighborhood now, is there any kind of public marker, or has it been swept under the rug? Has it kind of been forgotten by the city?
So the question is, what's the neighborhood like now? Is there any public memorial? There's no public memorial. The neighborhood is very spooky. The houses are, for the most part, condemned and boarded. The rebuilt houses are condemned and boarded up. And it's like a scar. It's like a scar. I mean, for the most part, you walk down those blocks and, you know, maybe one out of every six houses is inhabited in any way. They're mostly boarded up. And there's absolutely nothing in terms of, you know, a plaque or 11 people died here or any kind of memorial whatsoever.
Okay, let's do up top and then we'll come back down.
2 years after the burning down of the house, I recall hearing that the Philadelphia police were in a massive police scandal of corruption and lies and stuff. I think a lot of convictions got thrown out. And yet, there's still a bastion of police support for the campaign to keep Maria Bush model. And has anything changed with the Philadelphia police?
Well, I mean, I'm not an expert on that, but I do think things have changed. I mean, I don't think you would see the type of overt brutality that you see here. And in fact, Rizzo's police force was somewhat famous for. I think that's what this question was alluding to as well, or at least touching upon. And I, you know, what's in people's hearts, and are the police in Philadelphia racist? I don't know the answer to that. But I mean, would you see the type of brutality you saw through the 70s? No, I don't think you see that. Does it exist and we don't see it? I don't know. But at least in terms of a public presence, I do think things have changed. What does that indicate on the surface? That
bless
I'm less
you.
Sure of.
Yeah, I'm interested in the outcome for the residents who lost their houses. Did they sue, or are they compensated adequately? I mean, how are they doing today?
The question was about the residents who lost their homes and if there was a legal battle. So they did sue. There was a settlement. It played out over years and years and years. They were still collecting money in dribs and drabs, I think as late as 2001. I think it's all, and then because they had to sue again, you know, they were going to replace the houses. They had to sue again because the houses weren't replaced properly. And I mean, I think your deeper question, how are they doing? I don't know the answer to that. I don't know that anyone's really done that work, and I'm kind of interested, you know, a lot of, you know, we haven't brought this film to Philadelphia yet, and we're trying to think very carefully about how we do that and who we invite and how we engage with them. And I will say that the people you asked about, I'm very interested. I'm very interested in sort of the children. I mean, I was sort of the age of the children who died. But just recently showing the film, I've been thinking, geez, there are all these people that were also our age who left their house with, you know, 48 hours worth of clothes. And the adults given, but there were kids. There were 10 and 11 year olds that left their house with a bag and then could never go back to their house again. And I would really be interested in, you know, engaging with those people and having a round table. So I guess for myself personally, learning more about that and those stories in a personal way is something that I hope might come out of, you know, the outreach and engagement of the film in the city. Because I don't really know the answer and I'm interested.
Okay, we have time for one or two more. Let's start here.
I was wondering if Ramona and Michael had contributed to the film or seen it, and if there's any updates on how they're doing today.
So Ramona, I interviewed both Ramona and Michael, and there was a time when I thought I would use those interviews in the film, and they just didn't make the cut. Ramona saw the film about 3 weeks ago, and, you know, I don't want to, for a number of reasons, I don't really want to judge. First of all, I'm not inside her mind. Secondly, it was, I mean, one thing I know for sure, it was very emotional to watch the film for her. So even her initial reactions, I want to give her room to change her reaction too. I mean, it was a pretty difficult evening for her. I think generally my read on the reaction was sort of, you know, recognition that's not exactly what they would have done, but that there's great power in it, and it's a discussion starter, and, you know, I think they were pleased to have it done, and, you know, if nothing else, they are very sophisticated media people, and I think they understood immediately. They've seen a lot of sort of one-sided screeds done that don't really go anywhere besides they watch it and go, yeah, we were right. And they realize that a film like this will have, you know, a wider audience and gain attention. Michael is a more difficult case for me. I interviewed him about 7-8 years ago, and, you know, with some really delicate subjects, you often have conduits to them. And in my case, the conduit was the attorney who you see there, got in the name of David Schrager. And he's actually passed away, and there's a great story there. He's sort of a wonderful person that made a huge difference in Philadelphia and did a lot of amazing things, including representing Michael Ward pro bono from the time of the fire until the time he passed away. And he was still very active and talked to him on a regular basis. Unfortunately, when David Schrager passed away, I lost that connection, and I'm sort of struggling to figure out how to reach out to this person, because it was always, you know, you don't want to do more damage, right? And I had someone who was really in a position to really take care of him and make a decision about me. Yes, we can do this meeting, this guy's okay. And now that that person's missing, I'm not really sure how to reach out to him without doing more damage, so I haven't really done anything yet, but it's on my mind.
Okay, we have time for one more, if there is one more. Right there.
Hi, really good film, and not surprised you won an editing award.
My editor won an editing award. His name's Nels Banger.
I'm glad that you left, whether it was a cult or not, to the side, and just focused on sort of dissent versus terrorism. And I wonder if that issue being relevant today is part of what led you to the story.
Well, yeah, so the question was that, if I could paraphrase, when you remove some of the more specific questions, are they really a cult or not, you're left with the more broad thing that's maybe more relevant, which is, you know, when does dissent become terrorism, right? And I guess what I would say is, no, I mean, I was working on it before that was such a relevant issue to us, okay, but I guess maybe the best way to answer, I started working on this film a few months before September 11th. And so then September 11th happened, and it all went through my head, and I was like, crap, will anyone care about this? Like, will this be relevant now? And I was living in Washington, which of course was attacked, and I was walking around this, you know, boarded up city thinking about it, and I was looking to do this film. And at the time, if you recall, there was all this lip service about, you know, civilization has been attacked, right? And I'm thinking, I'm like, walking around, I'm like, civilization's been attacked. And I'm like, no, not really. I mean, civilization is not attacked when the attack happens, either type of attack. That's not when it happens. Civilization is under attack when 11 people can die and we just forget about it. Like, we just go on. We just move forward. So, thank you. I decided that day that it's more important and I really have to tell the story. And then, on top of that, the part of the reason to tell the story in this way is, unfortunately, until we solve a lot of problems, it's probably going to play as relevant to it plays relevant today, based on your comment, but I'm afraid that in 10 years, there'll be something going on that it's also relevant to. And part of the reason of doing the film this way is that it does indeed, and it will continue to have a relevance in different situations until we fix a lot of social problems anyway.
Okay, I'm sorry, that's all the time we have.